Today, 5D Amir Bakunga, and we're with Keith Gill, a training captain for Erickson Air Crane. Keith did an audio interview with us previously. Today, we'll get Keith to show us around the Erickson Air Crane and all the different parts. Keith, how are you today?
I'm good.
I believe we're standing in front of here, the open water snorkel.
Yeah, we commonly refer to this as the sea snorkel. There's two methods, or you could even say there's three methods of filling the tank. The tank's about 10,000 liters, and we can either manually hook this up to a hose and pump retardant or water in some cases into the tank, or we can use the pond snorkel that I'll get to a little bit later. And the third option is what we call the sea snorkel. We can use the sea snorkel in fresh water, but it was primarily designed to allow us to go over the surface of the water at about 50 kilometers per hour. And as this is lowered into the water and then dragged through, we fill the tank up by ram effect. It takes about 45 seconds to put 10,000 liters of salt or fresh water in the tank. And that's the beauty of the design, in that when we're going with forward speed, we don't get the salt water and the additional corrosion getting on the aircraft, and particularly it doesn't get in the engines, which is a bigger concern.
With such a rapid fuel, mm-hmm. Dragging it through the water, is the pond snorkel faster, or is it filling it via this method faster?
This is faster. The pond snorkel, for the same volume of water, would be about a minute, 60 seconds. So this is definitely the preferred method to fill. In South Australia, we're more likely to use fresh water, ponds, billabongs, rivers, and that sort of thing. If we've got a fire close to the sea or a large reservoir where we're comfortable about knowing the depth of it, then we could use the sea snorkel. But typically, we're using the pond snorkel.
Well, we'll move around a bit now and have a look at the pond snorkel.
Sure. The original design of the tank utilized the pond snorkel. The sea snorkel that we talked about previously came later when we realized we had to work in salt water. So the pond snorkel, it actually isn't a snorkel in as that it's more of a pump with a hose attached to it. In this end of the snorkel sits a hydraulic motor and a high performance outboard motor propeller. And when we drop the snorkel off the cargo hook, it goes down and into the water. Once it's in the water, we hit a hydraulic switch and pump the water up into the tank. As I mentioned before, it takes about 60 seconds to fill the tank.
I believe there's quite some weight there, you're telling me.
Yeah, we don't ever stand underneath it, even though it's on a cargo hook and it's got a safety pin in there. If it inadvertently released, you would have about 250 kilos of weight landing on you right there. About almost 300 kilos in the whole apparatus. So it's a fairly heavy item.
Behind us is the retardant tank on the air crane. Keith, can you tell us a bit about how this system works? Because I believe you can vary the flow of the water that you release.
Yes. The original tank was designed for a fixed wing and then modified over the years. It's designed to meet specifications set forward by the tanker board for certification. So the tanker board, and that's a US-based operation, but it has an effect worldwide, sets certain criteria for the tank operation. So we can operate the tank utilizing various door openings. And each door opening equates to a volume of liquid, retardant, or water coming out. It's simply numbers 1 through 8, and one would relate to a 3 meter by 3 meter area that would have 1 gallon of waterfall in it. So that's a relatively light rate, and it goes all the way up to coverage level 8, and then beyond that is salvo, which is we're just opening the tank and emptying it in about 2 seconds. So from 1 to 8 we get the what we call our coverage levels, and each coverage level is set forth for certain type of fuels and conditions. So on the ground or in the air, we may get a request for coverage level 5 over a certain drop. Mm-hmm. So we select 5 and away it goes. It's calibrated as well with our ground speed as set forth in the GPS. So if we're traveling downwind, obviously we would have one airspeed indicated, but a higher ground speed. So to compensate for the differences over the drop, the GPS is calibrated to the door opening, and it varies because of the speed that we're coming across the ground.
Keith, can you tell us a bit about the Pratt & Whitney engines on the aircrane?
Certainly. This is the first design of the engines, and we have two models of aircrane. We have an E and an F model. The E model engine develops 4,500 horsepower, and it's a bit of a thirsty creature, burns about 500 gallons an hour. The original engine design was installed on the Jetstar, which is, unless you're my age or older, you probably don't even remember that particular aircraft. But it's a good, simple, reliable engine. With two of them, we've got a lot of redundancy as far as power goes. And over the years, they've served us very well. We do all of our own overhauls on the engines. Some of the components we send out to other companies.
The two engines drive the rotor on a slight angle, I noticed. I think you said there's a 1 degree angle on the rotor. And the reason for that being?
The mast is offset about 3 degrees in total, and that's to handle something we call translating tendency, which basically simply means if we were to pick the helicopter up, it would tilt that direction. So picking it up and landing, we'd always have one side low. By building the offset into the transmission and mast, it more simply allows us to pick the helicopter up and land it in a level configuration. With a wheeled aircraft, you don't want to land it one side low. If you happen to be a little firm on your landing, you can create another problem with the helicopter.
Now we're looking here at the rear pod on the cockpit. Keith, can you tell us about the operator and the job there?
Sure. Originally, Sikorsky Skycrane was designed for doing external lift work, and when Erickson bought the type certificate, it became the Erickson Air Crane. But as far as the work that's performed, it's pretty much remained the same over the years. What you're looking back at here is the rear pilot station. This pilot can fly the entire helicopter from that position. He doesn't have full control authority over the flight regimes, nor does he need it, because when he's doing external load work, which is lifting something on a cable or a winch, he only needs to make small movements with the aircraft. So we don't have all the controls in for that station right now because we don't operate that station for doing water drops. We utilize it for construction type work. Any time we're building electrical towers, communication towers, things of that nature, we'll utilize a backseat pilot and a winch. The tank's not on, and then we just do our lift work that way. So it's an ideal system for doing construction because the operator's looking down at the entire load.
Yep.
We do similar work utilizing the left seat pilot in the bubble, but for the fine work that requires, you know, minuscule inputs, it's best done from the back seat.
Keith's just climbed up into the flight deck, and we'll let him tell you about all the controls on the Erickson aircrane.
Yes, David, up here in what we call the cock house rather than cockpit, is the controls to the Erickson air crane. The command pilot seat is located on the left side. The original design called for the captain or the command pilot to be on the right side. The reason we do the left side is that all of our external load operations are done utilizing the bubble window on the left hand side of the aircraft, which you may be able to see here. It's just ergonomically easier to lean out to the left while you're flying the aircraft than it is to the right. It's not a great deal of difference, but it's enough so that you might as well make it easier working off the left side. So like all helicopters, it has a cyclic and a collective, which you can't see here, but is located there. The collective changes the pitch on the helicopter. The cyclic basically tilts the rotor system and gives you your directional control. The pilot flying doesn't spend a lot of time looking at the engine instruments. The pilot non-flying is monitoring the engine instruments and other systems. The flying pilot's looking at the altitude, airspeed, and primarily looking out the window for obvious reasons. When we're working on a fire, we may have two or three radios, sometimes four radios working at once, other aircraft to be concerned about. So the pilot not flying is clearing the airspace. The pilot flying is primarily interested with troops, people on the ground, and where the fire is and what he has to do to extinguish the fire with his drops. That's the short version of what we do every day when we fly the aircraft.
Well, Keith, thanks for the tour of the air crane. It's good to see you back here in Adelaide again, and we look forward to catching up with you during the summer.
Yeah, it's good to be back. Last year was a slow season, and this year we've already had a few fires, so you never know how it's going to be. We've had a little bit of wet weather, but it doesn't take much heat to dry things out, and the fire danger is always around here with the way the houses are built into the trees, and everybody likes the vegetation, yeah. But it is definitely a hazard.
Well, we will catch up with you during the fire season, and
look
it's been good
to
talking
it.
To you. Thanks a lot.
See you later.
Ta.